so they could live red carpet lives like Rat Wrangle over here in New York or the rest of them. These people, they, you know why they feel like they're the elite and better than anybody else? Because that's the way they live. That's the way they're treated. So we can also save a lot of money, but we don't cut the sessions of these houses. We don't need new laws. And to stop this criminality that's going on with these construction firms and the sweetheart deals that the political thieves are giving them, they're ruining America's small business because they don't close down around the big guys. They would never do that if a huge pyramid shopping mall was there. Oh, no, no. But we'll inconvenience the small people so we can get them out of the way, and we won't have any competition at all, as you well know, as they're doing with the agricultural bill.
I would go one step further. I think you're being conservative. I would say bring in a group of scholars and humanists and ethicists to examine the state and federal and local ordinances and laws and repeal those that are really draconian, are punitive, and are counterproductive or counterintuitive. And I believe you would eliminate probably 90% of the laws now on the books.
I agree. And I agree. That's a great addition. No more new ones, and repeal all these draconian ones. That's what's going on. As I said it over and over again, all of these people out there calling, you know, Obama a communist, a Marxist. No, this is fascism. It's the merger of state and corporate powers, and they're abrogating more and more of our rights as we speak. Wasn't that a wonderful little story, by the way, that the liberals just turned a blind eye to last week? And this was in the New York Times, all over. Court dismisses a case asserting torture by CIA.
Yes.
And how the Obama administration has codified so much of the torture and rendition and other heinous acts that were put in place under the Bush administration. Not a peep. Not a peep. Like you had mentioned, the Obermans and all of the rest of them who suck up and will never say anything bad if it's going, they're going to lose favor with their masters. How could we call this a moral nation when we have laws like this in court? You know what, I've said this before, Gary. You could sum up what's wrong with the United States into six simple words. Harvard, Princeton, Yale, bullets, bombs, and banks. And when you look at now the Supreme Court, what kind of person who's awake at any level can't see how the fix is in when you have a so-called Supreme Court rigged with Harvard and Yale people? And again, they're the elites. They're better than we are. Just ask them. They'll tell you.
And the fact that we are refusing to examine the history of the Koch brothers and the other individuals who have put together massive fortunes to fund think tanks, the Cato Institute, the Free Enterprise Institute, the Heritage Foundation. There are now several hundred of these, and almost all of the people who are invited on television, either liberal or conservative, radio and TV, to give an opinion on something come from these foundations. And they're all talking corporatists. So I think it's rather remarkable that we never take the time to look at who benefits from the policies they're talking about. So when it came to the war in Iraq, they didn't invite you or I on to talk about why we shouldn't be in Iraq. Instead, they invite the generals on who all have contracts, never ask them for conflict of interest information. And so then we become a pro-war nation. We go up to as many as 70% of Americans wanting to see the war go forward. And now we're not willing to go back and hold anyone accountable for any of the crimes committed in the name of that illegal war. I say that this tells a lot about what we're not willing to be, honest and forgiving. I'm not seeking vengeance. I'm not seeking to put people in prison. I am seeking a truth and reconciliation commission, just as
This is where I would part company. I would love to see a war crimes tribunal and put people like Tony Blair and George Bush and Cheney. Who knew what when? You know, this Blair is, you want to talk about a sociopath. Did you see any of the excerpts from his new book?
Yes.
And he says things like he has, you know, he has no regrets about the Iraq war.
Well, why
even though
he wasn't
wrong.
The one injured or killed.
Yeah. And then he says things like that he was a manipulator, that he knew how to play on people's feelings. These people are sociopaths. Why, you know, if I have two drinks and I get stopped, you know, they treat me like a criminal. But yet we can't find out whether or not this nation was being taken to war for fake reasons. You know, why can't people call mass murder what it is? You have Obama killing people at a mass level, and you have it going on right now in Pakistan. Just go to Yahoo or any of put in Pakistan drone attacks. Every day they've been happening virtually. This is mass murder. Why aren't these people being brought up on war crimes? Because they're better than we are.
Well, also they control public opinion. One of the ways that the average person has been conditioned not to think is to have someone else do all the thinking for them. And in such a debate, whether it's on AIDS or obesity in children or our failed health care system or the destruction of our environment, you name the issue, you never really have the best spokespersons who represent a truthful position. Instead, you have all their bets covered. The ruling elite have funded both conservative and liberal think tanks, so they win. These are the Reagan Democrats, of which Obama's one, Clinton, male and female, are both, and Rubin was one, and they all honor. The politics is irrelevant. The party loyalty is irrelevant. It's making sure that the vested interests do well. Remember, when Clinton became a president, he was worth about $800,000. Now he's worth about $160 million. He is the wealthiest president in American history, post-president. And that, and his foundation's up close to $700 million. That came because he never once went after the people who were the real oligarchs and power holders in our society. Obama's not stupid. What's interesting to me is when I hear real stupid statements like O'Reilly or Glenn Beck or Sean Hannity saying, oh, the socialist Obama. To the contrary, if he were a socialist, then he would be redistributing wealth. He is not. He would stop the support of the corporate people feeding at the public trough. He has not. He would stop the military-industrial complex from massive gouging on profit-taking. He is not. He would have been concerned about people's ability to feed themselves and stop foreclosures by executive order and put a moratorium on them. He is not. So all the things that a real socialist would have done, he has done none of that. In fact, he has done everything that a neocon has done. And that's rather remarkable when William Crystal and others will say that, oh, he is a liberal, and I'm looking and saying, I'd like to know what he's done that is liberal. I haven't seen it. Your final closing comments.
Well, you're 100% of what you're saying about Obama. As I said, the merger of state and corporate powers is called fascism. And not only did Clinton not do anything to rein in the oligarchs, remember, it was under Robert Rubin and Larry Summers and their protege, Timothy Geithner, who's now Treasury Secretary, where they dismantled the regulations that made these rich banking firms become richer and bigger. And, of course, then after Robert Rubin leaves, where does he go? Oh, funny. He went to Citigroup, you know, after they became this huge business. And then when you listen to Obama, listen to one of his recent speeches, he's going to hold the line on spending, but I'm not going to take a penny away from national defense. And you tell a liberal that, and they say, well, you know, he only could do so much. He's doing his best.
Yeah.
So now the nation is lost as long as we have the Republicans and Democrats in power.
Gerald Celente, we're out of time. Thank you very much. I look forward to our next conversation. You can read more from the Trends Journal by going to trendsresearch.com. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. We'll have more tomorrow.